All right, will you come and take your seats, please? We're going to start the debate. You will want to be sitting down for this, trust me. We, at the Foundation, MasterCard Foundation, we've organized these conferences for a few years now. And a couple of years ago at one of the other conferences, we organized a debate on a particular topic. It was on financial inclusion. And we thought it would be a rather sedate affair. But in fact, the debaters really got into their positions, and it was very exciting to watch. So we decided to do it at a couple of other conferences, and we're doing it this year as well. So the issue, you'll see the question that will be formulated, which is around the idea of whether on-farm or off-farm activities offer the greatest potential, the greatest opportunity for young people today. There are clearly two camps, two sides to this issue. And the debaters are going to be here to debate that specific proposal. And more than just being passive observers, you will be asked your opinion at the beginning of the debate, and you will be asked your opinion at the end of the debate as well, to see whether they have persuaded you in your thinking on off-farm versus farm activities for young people. So, people in the front row, you might want to have some protective covering, because if the things start flying around, just be warned that it can get a little hectic. We have Peter Bamkole, who is the director of the Africa Enterprise Center and Pan-Atlantic University. He has the very difficult task of keeping the two sides apart, but also ensuring that their point of views are expressed fully. So please welcome Peter Bamkole and the debating teams. Come on out.
Since yesterday, we've had a lot of numbers thrown at us. But perhaps the most scary one is the number of youths that will be entering the job market every year. 11 million we heard yesterday. I tweeted yesterday and I said, if you were not convinced that agriculture is going to be a game changer, then you are in the wrong room. I also tweeted yesterday that if you were not convinced by what the youth is bringing to the table, then you need to raise your standards. So, but today, the proposition, the debate proposition is off-farm. Where is the greatest opportunity? Where lies the greatest opportunity? Off-farm. I'm going to take that again. It's within agriculture, off-farm activities will yield the greatest opportunity for youth. That is the proposition. And here, I have a team of young persons and slightly younger persons to help us to debate this proposition. And then on the off-farm side, which is the corn, I have Clarisse, and I have just slightly younger David. And then I have Grace, and then slightly younger Agnes. And so, but before we go into the debate proper, I'd like to get a sense of who is on which camp. And so can you quickly get your voting instrument? So off-farm is what number? One, two. Off-farm is one, and on-farm is two. So if you are for off-farm, you think that is where the greatest opportunity lies, then you press one. If it's for on-farm, that is where the greatest opportunity lies, then you press two. The voting starts now. You got, I think, 10 or 15 seconds. Wow. Don't worry, I'm just as nervous as you. Now the voting is closed. You can no longer vote. Can we have the results, please? Wow. We have a few undecided people. So, is that off-farm?
That puts the pressure on us.
So, people are saying it's off-farm. And we had a little conversation backstage. And I said, depending on what the audience says, I'm going to go for the other one. And so we will start with the on-farm. So, Grace, you have the table.
By the time we are done, you'll all be farmers, so I'm not even worried. My name is Grace Wanene, the founder of the Youth Agro-Environment Initiative. We are a community-based organization that produces banana seedlings and teaches young people from Central Kenya how to start and run their own successful farms. So we work with young people between 18 and 35 and teach them both the practical and theoretical skills to run their farms. And I love sharing the story of one of the young people I have worked with. His name is Moses. He's a garlic farmer. He has a 10-acre garlic farm where he earns $100,000 a year. But this hasn't always been his story. Before he started farming 5 years ago, he was earning $4 a day. He was running a mobile knife sharpening business. He was going from door to door sharpening people's knives. But then while doing that, he realized he could make more by selling fresh produce to these customers. So he started selling onions and garlic to them. And still while in that business, he realized there was a shortage of garlic in the market. So he started producing garlic. He started his farm with just $30. And within 4 months, he was able to convert that into $2,000. This is the story of many of the young people I work with. And for these young people, most of the job and business opportunities in agriculture will not come from off-farm. They will come from farming. And actually, you cannot even have off-farm opportunities without on-farm activities. So... so this entire team is reliant on us. And if you look at the situation at the moment, you'll find at every 1,000 liters of milk produced in Kenya employs 77 direct farm workers, but only 31 off-farm workers. So more than double are on-farm. And there are not only more opportunities on-farm for both business and employment, you also find that on-farm opportunities are more accessible to young people. You find that there are certain barriers that keep young people out of off-farm businesses. Those barriers are capital, knowledge, licenses, and market, and I'm going to unpack each one of those. If you look at the capital requirement for on-farm and off-farm, you find that on-farm activities, you can start with very little capital. Like Moses started with $30. Right now, he's making $100,000 a year. And if you look at, even myself, when I started farming, I started with around $100, which I had saved from my job. And when you look at the people in off-farm, you find that they require more capital. Like in the case of the Kilimo Biashara loans that are offered by Equity Bank, you find that farmers are borrowing $100 to $1,000, and the off-farm businesses are borrowing $1,000 to $10,000. They are borrowing 10 times more. If you look at the knowledge and skill requirement, to go into off-farm businesses, you often require some kind of formal training from an institution of higher learning. I have a degree. I'm currently pursuing a master's degree, but Moses, who has no post-secondary education, makes more money than me from farming. So you find that the knowledge you require for farming, you can get from extension officers, you can get from online platforms, like we run an online platform where youth can get information, you can get from other farmers. But for knowledge on off-farm, it's not very accessible for young people, especially those in rural areas. Licenses. The question of licenses was brought up this morning. I did not require a license to farm. Moses did not require a license to farm. If you want to go into off-farm businesses like agro dealership, in Kenya you need one license from the Pest Control Products Board, another one from the Kenya Plant Health Inspectorate Service, yet another one from the Kenya Veterinary Board that the farm shop Farouk was talking about in the morning, and another one from your local government, which is the business permit. I do not require any license. If you look at market access is very difficult for youth-owned off-farm businesses when compared to us. As a farmer, I am competing with other farmers, and I am competing with smallholder farmers who are still using the hand hoe and still doing the old things they were doing. If I do my modern commercial farming, I can outcompete them. But then when they are competing with multinational companies, people who have large budgets for research and development, and they are able to keep innovating, people who have marketing, large marketing and branding budgets, they also sometimes find themselves competing with state-owned corporations. Like in Kenya, we have the Kenya Seed Company. If you want to go into seed production as a young person, these people enjoy unfair advantages. Like the state-owned corporations have preferential access to markets. They get money from the government. They get loans. When they travel in trouble, they'll be bailed out. You cannot. It's not easy to gain market share in such a market. So to recap, it's not only that there are more opportunities for new businesses and employment on farm. It's also that these opportunities on farm are much more accessible to young people. Thank you.
Good. So to quickly support Grace, so I get it. I grew up on a farm. So I understand very well why many of you would think that, oh, I don't want to be part of that you saw on that farm when you were growing up. But let's be honest. There are 17 million young people entering the labor market every day, and only 20% or less get employed. So what are we going to do with the rest? You know. So I think that since my parents were farming and your parents were farming, so much has happened. In the last 10 years alone, the distance to the next agro dealership where you can find seeds and fertilizers has reduced from 50 kilometers to less than 5 kilometers. There are now motorcycles that take you to that village or that marshland where you're going to farm that you can go and farm without walking the same distance that your father walked to get to the land. In terms of labor productivity, we see so much in terms of how much you could get by using improved seed, how much you could get by using improved fertilizers. 5 times as much for the same land, for the same labor investment, if you use the right things. And why will youth do it differently? Because you have access to information that my parents didn't have. You have access to information in different ways. There's all sorts of digital platforms that provide information in terms of, even without land, where do I lease land? Where do I get, buy seeds? Where do I find fertilizers? Where do I find this? There's so much information. Now, there's a real myth around access to finance, that you must have land to access finance. But let's be honest. How many farmers sitting on land today have access to finance? Less than 5% of capital of commercial banks are lending to less than 5% goes to agriculture. So it's not because agriculture doesn't have land or people in agriculture don't have land. What young people have, that these people are sitting on land don't have, is knowledge, is skills, and ability to get knowledge and skills and capability and to know where to find them. And today, with the kind of platforms that we are creating, again, using digital information, we can generate credit histories, we can be part of informal saving groups, we can be part of saving platforms that allow us to access money. The other day I asked a young person, because I knew I was coming for this interview, I said, would you farm? Because I know completely, her mother is in information technology, and would you farm? She said, but you know what? A lot of young people are now going to farming. I said, why? Because it's easy to make money. If you want to create some form of money to invest in something else, go to farming. So you know what? There are real opportunities in farming that we need to exploit.
Thank you so much, the on-farm team. Now, the off-farm, you have a great challenge ahead of you. But I'm going to start with Clarisse. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm Clarisse Murekatate, and I'm a Rwandan young agripreneur who co-founded a company called CARL. CARL is a youth-led company that is currently specializing in food processing, where we add value to sweet potatoes and process them into baked goods. So coming back to my background, I am actually a graduate of quantity surveying. So I'm almost like off topic, but the reason why I chose this agribusiness is because I believe it's more of a passion than just an option for young people, because this is how I realized that my passion of baking and feeding the hungry led me into this field. So I really believe that off-farming is provides greater opportunities to young people than on-farm, because first of all, it opens door to diversity, starting by myself and my fellow friends like Rita and Brian, who have IT backgrounds but still found a way to use their skills to improve agriculture. And this diversity implies the involvement of more educated people in the sector of agriculture. And this makes off-farm a sustainable kind of business because it is done in a more smarter way and a more professional way. My second point is off-farm opens door to innovation. Like, have you ever heard bread made from sweet potatoes? Or I've heard also some ply boards that are used in construction and they are made from banana peels. So off-farming implies value addition and reduction of wastages and various innovation that could really impact the environment in a positive way. My other point is we don't need access to land because we don't have anything to do with growing crops. What we do is looking at that production and thinking outside the box and see how we can make a difference, improve it in a way that we add value to it and make it more marketable so that that product be able to have an impact in the community. And this also impacts the food security in one's community, because the more you make locally made products, the less we import from other countries. So this really ensures food security in our community. So my last point is job creation. We may not create as many jobs as on farm, but we create quality jobs, and that's what really matters. We don't create jobs in our own field. Actually, also provide jobs to the on-farm people, because without us, they wouldn't shift from subsistence to market-oriented kind of farming, because we are their market. So if we are not there, they will just stick to their traditional way of farming. So we are, I believe we are the key of the agricultural transformation.
Wow, David. Clarisse has set you up nicely, so go for it.
Thank you. Fantastic presentation so far. My name is David Tschirley. I'm in the Agricultural, Food, and Resource Economics Department at Michigan State University, and I've spent the last several years kind of trying to document and understand the implications of the dramatic changes that we see happening in African agri-food systems. So I want to support what Clarisse is saying, first of all, by stepping back and kind of taking the big picture, and then I'm going to get into a game of did you know. I'm going to put a lot of statistics out here that I think people are unaware of. So here basically is our argument. Africa will not prosper, it will not grow, it will not eliminate poverty without a dramatically more productive farming sector, okay? I think we all know that, we all accept that. But it is that very process of a growing, dynamic, more technological farming sector that drives the process of opportunity, value-added employment and opportunity increasingly moving off of the farm, okay? This is what's meant by the concept of structural transformation or the agricultural transformation that's kind of at the centerpiece of this conference right now. And it really amounts to an iron law of development. There is no country that has escaped poverty into middle income status, higher income status, without going through this process of progressive movement of economic activity and thus economic opportunity off of the farm. And I want to give you a sense for the intuition behind that. It's very simple. People, for example, can only eat so much rice. As their income goes up, they want fancier rice, they want packaged rice, they want processed rice. They don't necessarily want more rice, okay? people can only eat so much maize. As their income goes up, they want maize in highly refined meals, nice packages. They want their maize in beer, okay? They want their manioc in beer and so forth. This moves economic activity off of the farm and thus moves, in a relative sense at least, opportunity off of the farm as well. And some people can only eat so much maize and so much rice, no matter what the form is, okay? They also want to move into fresh items and perishable items. They want more fresh produce. They want meat. They want dairy, yogurt, cheese, all the different types of products that can be produced from that. Again, this is moving economic activity off of the farm. And finally, they don't want to prepare all their own food. All right, they don't want to put all the work into that. They want to buy processed food to make the preparation at home easier, all right? And they want to go out to eat more often. So as they move into meat, for example, they might want Leticia's rabbit as well as beef and so on and so forth. But as they get even higher incomes, they don't want to prepare Leticia's rabbit. They want to get Leticia's rabbit in carnivore restaurant in Nairobi. I hope some of you heard what she was talking about yesterday. So those are the essential elements in the background as to why we take the position that we do, and I'll stop for now. Thank you.
A round of applause for my panel. Okay, so this, we're going to just open up straight away. And we have about 18 minutes or so before we come back, and then they will do their wrap up. But ground rules very quickly. First, once you stand up, your name, your organization, and one question. No part A and part B. That's one. Two, don't thank MasterCard. I've already done that on your behalf. Just go straight to the point, and if you are becoming a little bit clumsy, I'm just going to tap on the microphone. Okay? So we're going to take the first set, about five of them. So I'm going to have this gentleman here. Can I have a lady at the back? Okay, no. So I'm going to have you here, one, two, and then I'm coming to this side. Yes, please. And then please let's know who you are directing, which of the team.
Okay, Mukiwi Shaban, Ugandan, agriculture technician. Do you think we shall only manufacture foodstuffs without farm concurrently? We only need to strengthen the food production chain. As it states, the position of commerce lies between the producer and the consumer.
Okay, thank you. Who are you directing this to?
I'm directing it to the group of off-farm.
Off-farm, okay. But please, the next speaker, let it be shorter than his own. He was writing the thesis.
I'm Tarus Gilbert, a Kenyan. My question goes directly to Chris. I am a farmer. We have got a challenge as farmers. We use the challenge where we may grow our vegetables, such as bananas. We have a person called known as middleman in between. He take advantage from the buyer and the seller. So the most person who is almost depreciating is the farmer. Please tell us what we do concerning this person. If you don't want to use it, you may not get a buyer.
Okay. Right at the back, the lady, the person in white. You can see. Yes, in white. The lady, yes, that's it. Can I have the microphone to the lady in white? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Janet Longmore with Digital Opportunity Trust. I loved what Clarissa said about innovation and creativity in off-farm. My question is to the on-farm team. There must be innovation and creativity that happens on the farm, and I'd love to hear from you on that.
Fantastic. So we take one more. Again, right at the back, right at the back. I'm coming to this side.
Thank you. My name is Ndongo from Kenya. My question is to the off-farm team. You create a very compelling vision for the future. And yes, it may have happened like that
straight
in the past.
Straight to the point.
We have 11 million young people who are going to enter the labor force next year. What do we do with them?
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to take that, yes, in front here. the gentleman in front.
I believe there are two forces acting in the farm supply chain. One is the production, which is the push force, and the pull force, which is working on the market end. I believe so much more in the strength at the market end, making the linkages and facilitating the producer to actually access the market. So I'm more for the off-farm.
So that's a comment, right? Okay. I was actually looking for... Okay, we're going to take just one more, and I'm going to take... just one more, and here in front, yeah. And then we'll see if we have more time.
My question is directed to the off-farm. What are you going to innovate, and what are you going to process without the on-farm? Mm-hmm.
Fantastic question. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys an opportunity, and you can answer. Let me start with, again, the on-farm.
I'll go first. I'll answer Tarus's question about the middleman and what you can do to get better prices for your products, maybe cut out the middleman. The thing, markets are not perfect, but what we encourage our young people, the young people we work with to do, is to do a market survey before they even start farming. What this helps is that you will be able to name your price because he has nowhere else to get whatever he's asking from you. So, and also there are initiatives that tell you what the price is at the market. Like if you look at the M-Farm, that tells you what the price is. So when you know the price, you can be able to negotiate better. And when you're farming something that you already know there is a market for, you can say no and he will come back. Say no and he will come back, I promise you, if you have something that he needs. We also have the initiatives that connect farmers directly to markets. Like in Kenya, we have an initiative called SokoText. How it works? It works in the slums areas, and it connects us as farmers. We have actually worked with them directly to the we call them mamambogas, but they are the small traders in the slums. They connect us directly to them. So what happens is that they have an initiative platform. It's an SMS-based platform where those women say what they need, and then we are sent a text and told what it is they need, and then we use a motorbike. We send it to the soccer text, and then the women get it in the morning. So there are initiatives that are being created by young people to cut out the middleman. You don't have to wait for soccer text to come to Eldoret. Do your own soccer text. Connect with the women directly at the market and put your produce on a motorbike and send it to her directly. So that is what you can do in terms of middlemen.
Agnes?
So there was a question on innovations that can be on-farm. Exactly. And there are quite a number of innovations. I'll just talk about things like right now the biggest challenge for youth in agriculture is mechanization. Right now we are talking about Uber tractors, right? We are talking about plant clinics. We are talking about all sorts of things that actually make it easy to farm. We are talking about CEOs in farming, right? You start your business as she is, you are a CEO. You don't have to be a CEO in someone's business. You are a CEO in your own business. But also, we are talking about first ladies farming. Ever seen Michelle Obama holding several pumpkins, and in the evening she's wearing that fancy dress going to one of those balls? It's cool to farm. There are lots of innovations that are happening on farm, and these innovations are making it very, very easy and very, very cool. So those were just to give a few.
Okay, so I'm going to start with the off-farm team.
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to answer Shaban's question, which is more alike with my brother's question about how we can make products without on-farm, because it's like we receive their raw materials from them. So, yeah, we need each other to be able to improve our livelihoods and so on. But I think we add value to the on-farm products because for us we can make one, we can process or add value to one product and make more products over only one product. So it's more of a value addition that we really emphasize on. And that also influenced the people on farm to make more improved and modernized kind of production, because they know that they have a market waiting for them. So I will let David, who's more experienced in this field, to add on.
I have no business experience, okay? Clarisse has the business experience.
So okay, David.
There you go. So, no, I just wanted to echo that. The fact is, obviously, both sectors are dependent on each other. The processing sector must have production locally or regionally, or they're not going to be able to compete with the imports. But by the same token, the producing sector needs a processing sector, needs a trading sector to be able to take those products, turn them into what consumers want, get them to where consumers are, and if they don't have that sector, then they're not going to be able to compete with imports. So both sectors are dependent on each other. It's a matter of co-evolution, co-development. The other question that was put out here was about what's going to be done with all of the entrants, the 11 million entrants into the labor market. We know that the vast majority of those entrants are going to go into the informal sector. We know that. They're dominantly going in there now. Over time, more and more will go into the formal sector. But for now, many, many, many are going into the informal sector. So what do we have to do? We have to do what a lot of people here are talking about doing, which is lots of training, lots of linking up with existing companies, access to credit. We need a whole kind of plethora and network and system of support to these people to give them the knowledge and the access to capital and the access to markets they need to be able to prosper.
Okay, great. So I'm going for brevity. So I need more questions, more challenging questions. Yes, please. I'm always going to move like this. So.
Hi, my question is about land. Where are we going to get this land? Are we going to make 11 million new plots? I would like to hear this debate, because we're not going to have more on-farm jobs if we don't have the space to do it.
Fantastic. So access to land, where are we going to get it from? Yes, please. The lady right at the back. Okay, no problem.
Hi, my name is Feni from Kenya. I would like to address a question to the on-farm group. Do you think that on-farm activities necessarily implies improvement in food security? Food security meaning availability, affordability, and quality of food. Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to move right at the back. Yes, right at the back. The lady at the back, yes, you.
My question is to the on-farm people. How do I get, yesterday we heard the young people saying that the elders should give way to the youngsters to take on. How do you make it sexy for the youngsters to go on-farm?
Okay, so I take that gentleman, yeah.
Thank you. My name is Charles Owing from VSO Uganda. My question to off-farm is, can't we do value addition and agro-processing on-farm? Thank you.
Okay. Trying to merge the two. Okay. Any other question from this side? Yes, please. Over here.
Thank you. My name is Rosine Urujeni from Indigo Africa. My question goes to on-farm group. How can on-farm become more sustainable and profitable without GMOs, specifically regarding productivity, food security, and export business? And this question goes specifically for Dr. Kalibata, because I know she was the Minister of Agriculture here in Rwanda. Specifically to Rwanda, is there any regulations to avoid GMOs and its consequences, especially health-related and soil-related issues? Thank you.
You broke my rule, parts A and B. You're supposed to ask only one question, but we'll take it all the same. All right, last question. Who wants to take the last one? Yes, please.
Greg from Restless Development. My question goes to both sides of the argument. What time frame are we talking about? I take the point about a shift in demand and more opportunities in the off-farm sector as that demand starts to shift. But if we're talking about the next 10 years, is it not many more opportunities for more young people on the farm?
Okay, so we're going to take the rounds. I'm going to start with off-farm this time, and then I'll end up with on-farm. Okay? So, Clarisse?
Thank you. I'm going to answer Charles' question about if we can't do value addition and agro-processing on-farm. Actually, I should ask the on-farm people because they are the ones to know better. But, yeah, I think people in the off-farm sector are not only farmers. They don't have agriculture background or profession. So if they can use their own skills to improve what is done on-farm, and I think not everybody on-farm who has only an agriculture experience or background can be able to use that value, can be able to add value to his crops with enough skills because he lacks something more than just agriculture. So I believe that even if you may add value in on-farm, you will lack these additional skills that is added in the on-farm part.
David?
So yes, very quickly, a value addition on on-farm. There is some value addition on-farm. We would like to think that there could be more. The research we're doing, however, and I'll talk about this later, there's a lot of processed foods coming, penetrating rural areas, and most of that is coming from urban areas. And you'll get processed foods going, you know, into the urban areas, coming back to rural, and being lower priced than the foods processed in rural areas. So it's not that it can't be done. It is being done some, but there are major challenges in terms of access to energy and scale of operation to get costs down and to be competitive. The question on time frame was excellent. This is what this is all about. So I would say two things. Number one, yes, over the next 10 years, I think the data is actually clear. And simply in terms of the number of jobs, there will be more, sorry, undermining my position here, but there will be more on the farm than off the farm. But, and I'll get into this later too, but when you get at the returns to labor, the returns per job, and if you look at the number of farming jobs that will give returns like you typically get off of the farm, that number is very low. So,
okay, Grace?
Yes, I'm going to take the land question. It's true that youth do have a challenge in access to land, but actually it's mainly young women. But before we go into that, there is 60% of agricultural land in Africa unused. So where is this land? Who's holding this land? In our initiative, one thing we have found is that it's easy to unlock the land in the hands of institutions for young people. One of the things we have done, and also CAD Africa, who spoke in the morning, has done the same thing, is negotiating on behalf of these young farmers to churches like the Catholic Church, who own a lot of land, to institutions like colleges. The land they are holding, they are willing to lease it to the young people. But then there has to be somebody to negotiate, to step in between the young people and create that kind of discussion, to even start off the discussion. Like in my case, when we started the banana seedlings, we started in a Catholic church. But of course, because of culture, things work a certain way. So we formed a youth group and sent one of the church leaders to go and speak to the priest on our behalf so that he can allow us to lease the land. And we actually managed to access that land. There's also another initiative in Kibwezi in Kenya where IITA has negotiated on behalf of a youth group so that they can utilize the land owned by the Nairobi University for horticultural farming. So this land is there and it's available to lease. Even the Agriculture Development Corporation has land in Kenya which they lease freely to young people. So yeah, there are initiatives that can allow young people to access land. And we also promote initiatives that don't need land. We train young women on mushroom farming. It does not require land. So there are things that can be made to increase access for young people on land. Then if we look at making agriculture sexy, being rich is very sexy.
That's a good one.
So when we talk about agriculture, we are not talking about young people becoming smallholder farmers, the same smallholder farmers we talk about. Young people want to be commercial farmers. So we are talking about a modern, commercial, technologically driven kind of agriculture. So that kind of agriculture, you're not even, you do call yourself a farmer because there is nothing wrong with the word farmer, but you're more of a manager. And when you're rich, you have no problem with people finding you sexy.
Okay, Agnes, you have just 1 minute to hit it.
Yeah, thank you.
Just 1 minute.
Yeah, so I have 1 minute. I wanted to say two things. One, that there's a real misconception that I'm picking that people farm, that farming is for food security. I want to say that young people, the only reason young people would go to farm is because it makes business sense. And I would like to make sure that where we are going, even everybody else who is farming, it's not just for food security, because it makes sense. So the markets and markets. The other misconception I picked up here is the fact that people think that you, because you're farming, you have no knowledge. Actually, you have to have significant amounts of knowledge and skills to be able to be a good job in farming. The only reason farming is still backward today is because it doesn't have that knowledge base among the majority of the people that are farming. Young people bring that to farming. They will bring significant knowledge to farming.
Okay. A round of applause for my team again. Now, we've had the first round of debates. We've had the Q&A. I think we have a golden opportunity now to sway them to our sides. All right? So, and I'm going to go in the reverse order. So I'm going to start with you, Agnes, then Grace, and I'm going to come like this. Okay. So you have the final opportunity for you to sway them.
First of all, let me just say that if you listened very carefully, the on-farm, off-farm opportunity group is actually arguing for on-farm. If you listened very carefully. So let's start from there. But let's also be honest. Today, youth are contributing more than one-third of GDP, of African GDP by farming. So youth are already in farming. Just to put that number out there. We are importing significant amounts of food. And you know what? The reason we are importing $40 billion of worth of food is not because we don't have off-farm activities or people that are interested in engaging off-farm activities. The reason we are importing so much food is because we are not producing enough to sustain businesses off-farm. So the only way we can get into off-farm significantly and make real value out of it is if off-farm takes off. So this continent significantly needs serious injection of knowledge and skills in on-farm farming. And it is a real business. Again, think about the $40 billion we are importing. Think about the fact that within 30 years, we have to produce 70% more food. If you're a business person, you're thinking market and market and market. So to me, there's no way around it. We can wish all the off-farm we want. We can think that off-farm is sexy. But like my partner said, if you have very good money in your pocket, if you can fly to New York and attend a meeting, if you can come to the AGRF like very many young people do, if you can challenge your president sitting in front of you around what you want to see in farming, how sexy do you want farming to be? I mean, and I've seen this, I see this in every forum that we hold in at the AGRF, Africa Green Revolution Forum, where young people are actually challenging business people. Why aren't you taking us up? Why aren't you creating opportunities? Why isn't financing working better for agriculture? That's what we need to do. African off-farm will not take off until Africa's on-farm takes off. And it will only take off if African young people that have the skills and knowledge take it on and make it sexy. Thank you.
Okay, Grace. Nail it.
Yes. I appreciate the arguments that the off-farm side has made. But at the end of the day, the bottom line is there can be no off-farm opportunities without our farming. You cannot be selling inputs or selling equipment when there are no farmers to buy them. And you cannot be processing if I have not produced. So at the end of the day, on-farm is going to create more opportunities for youth. But when we talk about these on-farm opportunities, young people do not want to even be subsistence farmers. That's why you hear people saying young people don't want to farm. No, I'm a farmer. I work with these young farmers. They do want to farm. They just don't want to be toiling all the whole day under the sun and then not be able to feed themselves or their families. They want to be a commercial farmer. They want to be part of a dignified, modern, technologically driven agriculture. And it is this modern agriculture that will create opportunities both on-farm and off-farm by increasing productivity and growing the economy. And if you remember nothing else from what I've said, remember that there is no off-farm without on-farm.
Okay, so David, they have set up a big tax for you guys.
Okay.
Go
so,
for it.
So I'll just pick up from what Rachel said, and I will say, and without the off-farm to link production to markets, there is no, there's going to be very little opportunity on-farm, okay? So I want to go back to our iron law. What you're talking about, in fact, over time, undermines your very argument. More technological, productive agriculture will in and of itself drive the process of more and more labor moving off of the farm. Over the next 10 years, certainly 15 years and out, it's starting to dominate. Okay, so I want to play a game of did you know? Did you know that already today in East and Southern Africa, about 40 to 50% of labor that takes place in rural areas is off of the farm? Already, 40 to 50% of full-time equivalent, what we call labor, in East and Southern Africa takes place off the farm, not on the farm. That's only going to increase over time. Did you know that in rural areas of East and Southern Africa, about half of all food that is consumed is purchased? It doesn't come from the person's own farm. This requires marketing. It might require some processing. It requires value addition off the farm. Did you know that a lot of that food that's coming into rural areas is coming from urban areas? It's being produced in rural areas, shipped to urban, being processed, coming back, and being sold. Again, value addition off of the farm. And I just said that much of that is coming in processed form. Did you know that the poor in Africa consume almost as much processed and perishable food in their total basket of food consumption as the rich? This penetration of processed food is all across the income spectrum. It's happening very much in rural areas as well. Again, we're talking about value addition off of the farm. In fact, and I would love to have this graph that I show frequently, but it's very dramatic when you look at the rate of change in diets. It's most rapid among the poor. They're rapidly changing their consumption away from basic grains to processed foods, fresh perishable foods, and so on and so forth. Again, value addition off of the farm. Did you know that demand for food away from home is likely to triple over the next 15 years? It has systematically the highest income elasticities of demand for food. And it's heavily dominated by women, provides great opportunities for women, and I would say for youth as well. About 15 to 20% in a number of countries of all food expenditure already is in food away from home, and that's growing very rapidly. So now we then get to the issue not just of the number of jobs, but of the quality of jobs. Did you know that in Nigeria, when we look at average output per worker, in food manufacturing, it's about four times the average output per worker in farming. In food marketing, it's about 50% higher than in marketing, than in production. In food away from home, it's about five times higher than it is in production agriculture, okay? These are average returns or average output per labor. You know, in Tanzania, in Rwanda, the numbers vary, but the basic story is the same. The returns to labor, the earning possibilities overall are simply much higher off of the farm. Okay, so there is no question that high value horticulture, okay, dairying, poultry production, these are going to generate very high returns. You'll be able to be a sexy farmer, you know, doing that kind of thing, okay, earn lots of money. But by the very fact that they are high earning, it means they're generating few jobs. Again, it's this fundamental logic that we simply can't escape. So I would summarize what we say in four points, all right? First of all, non-farm is already a major and rapidly growing a portion of work, even in rural areas. Second, there's a diet transformation that's going on across rural and urban areas and across the income distribution that's only accentuating it. Third, job quality, the quality of job, the earnings off the farm. And fourth, yes, profitable farming, but few jobs. Thanks.
Okay, so I'm going to give Clarisse the very last point.
Thank you. As a young lady in agribusiness, I've been driven into this field because I saw opportunity in off farming. I saw its potential because, trust me, its market is unlimited. Its demand is continuously increasing. So as young people, we should be attracted into this field because it helps us use our energy efficiently, not only in a tiresome way, but in a smarter way. And also it helps us be more, use our innovative abilities efficiently and be able to think outside the box. And believe me, it's the place where you can start small and grow big. So if you've seen in the past years how of farming has impacted the world, now imagine in 10 years. So if you're really concerned and willing to be economically independent, I would advise you to choose off farming.
Okay. A round of applause for my exciting, energetic, youthful team. I don't know, but there's something I didn't tell you at the beginning, that I'm actually neutral. So, you see, I was just smiling all through. But you cannot be neutral. And so, yesterday when we had a conversation, I predicted something. And I said, the audience is going to vote off-farm. And you guys just fell right into my hands. And then I predicted what you are going to vote after the... But I will not tell you that.
Yeah.
I will tell you after the voting. Okay? So, once again, pick up your voting tools. So, let's have the deal on. So, again, it's exactly the same. If it's on farm, I mean off farm, it's one. If it's off farm, it is two. And, sorry.
Off farm is one.
Yeah. If it is off farm, it is one. If it is on farm, it is two. And if you belong to the group that don't know or have not decided, I think it is three, right?
Yes.
Okay, the voting starts now. Yeah, it's open now. Dum, dum, dum. Now this is the moment we've been waiting for. Have you been able to sway? Or all these that we have been talking about doesn't matter. Before we display, just hold it, Don't display yet. Whatever happens, just know that we are one family. This is very important. So don't go around snubbing or beating anybody.
This isn't a football game.
But somebody's got to win the debate.
Yeah.
And so it's very clear in my mind that I think they both need each other. I think we agree on that.
Yes.
Okay, so let's have the result.
But you made up some
Well, I think this is a very interesting audience.
Yeah.
It's either you were not listening or you have made up your mind even before you started listening, or it doesn't matter. Whichever way, I think the gap has been closed a little, which means we have done a good job.
Yeah, that's right.
But for me, I think what is more important is the interconnectivity and the reliance on one another. And that, for me, it's crucial as we begin to make this transformation that we all dream about are in this sector. And for those of you in blue, you need to make up your mind quickly. You cannot, after 1 hour of debate, still remain blue. I thank you very much. You're a wonderful audience. Thank you, David. Thank you, guys.